Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. My name is Dr. Muhammad Ali and I will be teaching you chapter 14, Introduction to Metabolism. We will be studying this chapter from the Fundamentals of Biochemistry, Life at Molecular Level, 5th edition. Understanding the chemical composition and the 3D structure of the biological molecules is not enough to understand how they are assembled in life and how they sustain our life. To understand the life, we must understand how these biological molecules are degraded to provide the free energy, and how they are converted into the simpler molecules, and then how these simpler molecules build the complex molecules to build our tissues and our body. Metabolism is the overall process in which free energy is generated from the degradation of the biological molecules, in which catabolism is the degradation of nutrient molecules that are broken down to provide the simpler molecules, and the energy is also reaped. In the anabolism, the simpler molecules are joined together to make the complex molecules, and these molecules are utilized to build our body. So the key concept in this section will be how different organisms adopt different strategies to get energy to sustain life and to perform everyday work. And we will also see how mammalian nutrition involves the protein, carbohydrates and lipids, and the micronutrients involve the vitamins and minerals. A metabolic pathway is the pathway that involves the enzyme mediated reactions. This way the different reactions are performed in different compartments, different organelles of the cells. The flux of material through which the metabolic pathways are regulated depends upon the irreversible reactions that are catalyzed by the enzymes. These flux controlling enzymes are regulated by the allosteric mechanism, covalent modification, substrate cycling, and the change in the gene expression. Nutrition involves the food intake and the use. Food supplies the energy that is utilized to sustain our life. It is also utilized how to build and repair our body. Some of the autotrophs in the class of prokaryotes are utilizing the water, carbon dioxide, ammonia and hydrogen sulfide as their energy source. Some of the chemolithotrophs obtain their energy from the simpler molecules like ammonia, hydrogen sulfide or even from the iron. So we have listed here three reactions in which the ammonia is utilized and energy is produced, and the hydrogen sulfide is utilized in this reaction, and the ferrous carbonate is utilized in this reaction. Photoautotrophs are those that essentially utilize the light energy and convert the carbon dioxide into the carbohydrates. These carbohydrates are further utilized to produce the free energy. Heterotrophs obtain free energy from the oxidation of the organic compounds. These organic compounds include carbohydrates, lipids, and the proteins. And thus, the heterotrophs depend upon the autotrophs for their energy requirements. Nutrition involves the food intake and the use. The class of obligate aerobes utilize oxygen to survive, while the anaerobes utilize the sulfate and the nitrate to oxidize the biological molecules to produce energy, while the facultative aerobes like the E. coli can grow either in the presence or in the absence of oxygen. Obligate anaerobes are poisoned by the presence of oxygen. They always live in the places where there is low oxygen or there is no oxygen. Obligate anaerobes resemble the earliest life forms that was present when there was no oxygen on the earth. Vitamins and the minerals. They assist actually our metabolic reactions. Vitamins are the organic molecules that our body is unable to make. That's why we obtain the vitamins from the diet. There are two classes of vitamins. One is the water-soluble vitamins and the other one is fat-soluble vitamins. Most water-soluble vitamins are in the form of coenzymes. Initially, coenzymes were discovered as the growth factors, and they were proven to cure the nutritional deficiency disease. The example of vitamins is nicotinamide and the nicotinic acid. This table is showing different vitamins, the water-soluble vitamins and the fat-soluble vitamins. In the water-soluble vitamins, we can see biotin is there, pantothenic acid is there, cobalamin is there, riboflavin is there, and we can see thiamine is there, that is called the vitamin B1, and this vitamin is the part of enzyme thiamine pyrophosphate, and the reaction carried out by this enzyme is the aldehyde transfer. And the deficiency of this vitamin causes the beriberi disease. If we see the fat soluble vitamins like vitamin A, it is involved in the vision, and its deficiency causes the night blindness. Vitamins and minerals assist the metabolic reactions. So we do have some major minerals in our body like sodium, potassium, chlorine, calcium, phosphorus, magnesium and sulfur. So these are present in major quantity in our body. Some of the minerals are present in minor quantity in our body. Those are called trace elements like the iron, like the copper, like the zinc, selenium, iodine, chromium and the fluorine. Metabolic pathways consist of series of enzymatic reactions, and all the reactants and the products that are formed during the pathway of the metabolism are called the metabolites. There are almost 4,000 of the metabolic reactions that have distinct enzymes. So the types of enzymes and the metabolites vary from cell to cell, from organism to organism, and from the nutritional status and from the developmental stages. They also vary from tissue type to tissue type. Many metabolic pathways are branched and are interconnected. So if we want to study a metabolic pathway separately, we have to follow a set of rules and we have to keep the chemical logic to understand one single pathway, because they are always linked with other metabolic pathways. Metabolic pathways consist of series of enzymatic reactions. So what we see, whatever we eat, those things are degraded to make the simpler molecules, and during the degradation the high energy molecules are formed like NADPH, like ATP, and some simpler products are also formed. These energy molecules and simpler products are utilized during the biosynthetic processes, and they are converted into ADP, hydrogen phosphate and NAD+, and the complex molecules are generated to sustain the life to build our body. So what is the fate of every of the nutritional molecules that we are eating? What happens to those molecules? Like we are eating protein, proteins are converted into amino acids, and some of the amino acids are converted into pyruvate, and some are converted into the acetyl-CoA, and then these amino acids enter into the citric acid cycle to produce NADH and FADH and GTP. And some extra amino acids are degraded down to ammonia and are excreted from the body. Polysaccharide has a fate to be converted into the glucose. Then the glucose enters into the glycolysis, and then this glycolysis produces the final product pyruvate, then acetyl-CoA, and then this enters into the citric acid cycle. Triglycerides are broken down to produce fatty acid and glycerol, and these fatty acids are converted into pyruvate and acetyl-CoA, and thus again fuel and help the citric acid cycle. So NADH and FADH that are produced are utilized during the oxidative phosphorylation to produce the ATPs. So these are some of the organic compounds in which the carbon do have the different oxidation state. In organic compound, usually carbon has a valency of 4, but the oxidation state differ from one molecule to another in which the carbon resides. During the metabolic reactions, interconvergence and the degradation occurs, and the exception of a few, most biosynthetic pathways are catalyzed by the enzymes. In the absence of enzyme, the reaction would go very slowly, and also we will not get a specific product, and also there will be a lot of side product that will cause toxicity inside the cells. That's why enzyme catalyzed reactions are very specific and useful in our body. Most importantly, enzyme help to go uphill to proceed the antagonic chemical reaction that otherwise would not be possible. There are four classes of the enzyme that catalyze different metabolic reactions. Like the first class is the oxidation and reduction. The second class pursues group transfer reaction. The third class pursues elimination, isomerization, and the rearrangement reactions. While the fourth class pursues the reaction that make a break of carbon-carbon bond. So the metabolic pathways occur in specific cellular locations. The metabolic reaction pursued in a way that they occur in different compartments and different organelles. For example, the electron transport chain and the oxidative phosphorylation occurs in mitochondria, while the glycolysis and fatty acid biosynthesis occur in the cytosol. Metabolic processes in prokaryotes, which like organelles, occur in different areas of the cytosol. The synthesis of the metabolites occur in different compartments, and after they are synthesized, they are transported to other parts of the cells, and we do need the transport proteins for this purpose. For example, even if the ATP is synthesized in the mitochondria but is transferred from mitochondria to other parts of the cells through transport proteins. So these are the different organelles, different compartments of a cell, and they are performing specialized function, like cytosol is performing glycolysis, pentose phosphate pathway, fatty acid biosynthesis, and many other reactions of gluconeogenesis. And we can see rough endoplasmic reticulum is involved in the synthesis of membrane bound proteins and the proteins that are secretory. Smooth endoplasmic reticulum is involved in the lipid and steroid biosynthesis. If we see the mitochondria, these are involved in the citric acid cycle, the electron transport and oxidative phosphorylation, fatty acid oxidation, and the amino acid breakdown. If we see nucleus, it is involved in the DNA replication, transcription, and we can see in the RNA processing. Golgi apparatus are involved in the post-translational modification of the membrane and secretory proteins. Peroxisomes that are present in the animals and glycosomes that are present in the plants. Oxidation reaction are catalyzed in peroxisome that contains acid oxidases and the catalases, while in plant glycosylate cycle occurs in the glycosome of the plants. And the lysosomes are involved in the degradation of superfluous proteins and the misfolded proteins. If we see different metabolic pathway and we see different reactions, they occur in specific cellular locations. Actually, in multicellular organism, the different organelles and the compartmentation is carried a step further. Like there are specialized tissues and specialized organs, they perform specialized metabolic reactions. Like the example of liver. Liver is involved in the synthesis of the glucose, and thus it keeps the constant level of glucose. In the same way, adipose tissues are involved in the storage of triglycerides. The interdependence of metabolic functions among the various organs is the subject of chapter 23. So the location and the enumeration of all the metabolites is not enough. It does not tell us in which direction the reaction will go. It cannot even determine the directionality of a metabolic pathway. So in order to find the direction, we have to know the thermodynamics of different reactions that are involved in different metabolic pathways. Let's consider the thermodynamics. For example, A and B are reactants. They are reacting together to make the product C and D. During this reaction, the change in free energy is equal to delta G naught prime plus RT ln, product of the concentration of the products to the product of concentration of the reactant. At equilibrium, delta G is equal to the zero, and delta G naught then becomes equal to minus RT ln K equilibrium. Thus, the value of delta G can be calculated from the equilibrium constant and vice versa. Thermodynamic dictates the direction and regulatory capacity of a metabolic pathway. Metabolic pathways are irreversible that determine the direction of a reaction. The irreversible reactions are usually exergonic. They do have the delta G value is less than zero. They excrete energy when they occur. So that's why these reactions cannot be reversed without the provision of energy. Thus, they determine the directionality of a metabolic reaction. Every metabolic pathway has a first completed step. Usually during a metabolic pathway that is containing multiple reactions, among earlier steps, there is one step involved that is exergonic and that determines the pathway to go down the way. This way, the direction of the metabolic pathway is determined by a first early step, that is committed step. Catabolic and anabolic pathways differ. Usually, when one reactant is converted into the product 2, so it is adopting this pathway. When the reactant 1 is required by the body or the cells, so 2 is converted into 1, but it does take a different path, that is other than the path during which it was formed. It takes a different path, and usually this path requires energy from outside, and these are endergonic reactions and these are exergonic reactions. So this way, the direction of a pathway is determined by the exergonic and endergonic nature of forward and reverse reactions. Metabolic flux must be controlled. The metabolic flux is controlled by the enzymes. For example, a pathway is keep going on in a steady state. It means it is providing continuously some of the metabolites to go down the way. For example, the flux of a metabolite is J. So this flux can be calculated by the rate of forward reaction Vf and by the rate of reverse reaction Vr, and this becomes equal to J is equal to Vf minus Vr. At equilibrium, there is no flux and J becomes equal to zero. If the forward reaction is very very fast as compared to reverse reaction, then the J becomes almost equal to the Vf. Let's consider this condition. Under this condition, J becomes equal to Vf. Metabolic flux must be controlled. So there are different mechanisms to control the metabolic flux. So one approach that our cells adopt is the allosteric control. Here in this example, for example, A product is converted into B by the utilization of this enzyme, and B is converted into C and C is converted into P. Concentration P of P is in a way that it inhibits the enzyme that is carrying out the first reaction. So the P product has a negative feedback effect on its own pathway. And allosteric inhibition is that inhibition in which other than the active site is acted upon to change the activity of the enzyme. Covalent modification. Sometimes enzyme is covalently modified to control the metabolic flux. Under the covalent modification, either the phosphorylation is performed or dephosphorylation is performed, sometimes ubiquitination is performed, sometimes deubiquitination is performed, sometimes lipidation is involved in the covalent modification. Usually hormones are involved in this kind of modification of different enzyme in a metabolic pathway. Metabolic flux. So substrate cycle is another way in which the metabolic pathways are controlled. For example, A is converted into B and B is converted into C through a pathway that is called the F. And if C has to convert back to the B, it has to adopt a pathway R. So this kind of different pathway from the rect to the product and product to the rectant is called the substrate cycle. So this kind of substrate cycles are very sensitive during the allosteric regulation. Genetic control is another way in which the metabolic flux is controlled. Enzymes activities are regulated sometime at genetic level, like promoter region of some individual is in a way that the transcription factors are not making enough mRNA and thus not making enough protein. Sometimes protein modification is there in an individual that is making it less active or more active. So this way genetic control is another way to control the metabolic flux. High energy compounds. Key concept in this session will be how organisms capture energy and convert them into the ATP. The high energy ATP is related to the large and active high energy change for the hydrolysis of the phosphoanhydride bond. Third key concept in this section will be ATP hydrolysis can be coupled to an endergonic reaction, thus overall reaction is favorable. Fourth concept will be phosphoryl groups are transferred from compounds with high phosphoryl group transfer potential to those with low phosphoryl group transfer potential. And the last one, the thioester bond in acetyl-CoA is a high energy bond. So let's talk about the high energy compounds. Like in this equation, we can see glucose is broken down into carbon dioxide and water, and the standard free energy change is equal to 2850 kilojoule per mole. If we see the example of palmitate, the equation for the oxidation of palmitate is written here. So the palmitate is producing -9781 kilojoule per mole of energy. This energy is a lot higher as compared to the energy of the glucose. So during the oxidative metabolism, the energy is released in a stepwise fashion. The packets of energy are conserved in multicellular organisms, especially in the form of high energy intermediates. And whenever energy is required, these high energy intermediates drive the formation of ATP. ATP has a high phosphoryl group transfer potential. So this is the structure of ATP. We can see in this structure, this is adenosine part, and these are three phosphoryl groups. These three phosphoryl groups are connected to the adenosine part through a phosphoester bond, and there are also two phosphoanhydride bonds that are coupling, that are joining three phosphoryl groups. So these are the free energy changes of different high energy molecules. Like the phosphoenol pyruvate is having -61.9 kilojoule per mole of energy. If we see the acetyl phosphate has -43.1, and this is the free energy change for the glucose, that is glucose 1 phosphate, that is -20.9. ATP is hydrolyzed to produce ADP and inorganic phosphate, and ATP can also produce the AMP and pyrophosphate. So ATP has a high phosphoryl group transfer potential. So there are three reasons that ATP is a high energy molecule and high phosphoryl group transfer potential. The first reason is that its hydrolysis products are at higher energy as compared to its resonance stabilization effect. We can see here these lone pairs are shifted to this bond, and this bond becomes double bond in nature, and this electron pair then shifted onto the oxygen. This way, this attraction of this lone pair between the two highly electronegative atoms is stabilizing its resonance effect. But this resonance effect is weaker as compared to its hydrolysis product. The second reason is that because the phosphoanhydride bond is containing negatively charged oxygen region that are repelled to each other, and that's why they are at higher energy. This is destabilizing. The third reason is that solvation energy of phosphoanhydride bond is lower as compared to its hydrolysis products. These three reasons make the ATP as a high energy molecule. These are different resonance stabilizing structures of phosphoinhydride bond, and these are the resonance structures of its hydrolysis products. Some other phosphorylated compounds have high phosphoryl group transfer potential. High energy compounds other than ATP are essential to keep the energy metabolism. In this equation, we can see that amino acid is there and one ATP comes in action and interact with this one and makes amino acyl adenylate, and one pyrophosphate is removed from this ATP. Next, this amino acyl adenylate interacts with transfer RNA and makes amino acyl transfer RNA and AMP is released. So y-axis here is showing the free standard free energy change we can see along the y-axis. So these are the high energy molecules that are above this point, like phosphoenol pyruvate is at minus 60 kilojoule per mole of energy, 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate and phosphocreatine. These are all at high energy. They are utilized to keep the energy metabolism, and whenever is required, they provide energy to produce the ATP. This ATP is used to add the phosphate group, the lower energy molecules like the glucose 6 phosphate and glycerol 3 phosphate. If we take example of some other high energy molecules, acetyl phosphate and 1,3 bisphosphoglycerate also have the phosphoanhydride bond, and this phosphoanhydride bond has resonance stabilization effect, and their hydrolysis products are at low energy as compared to their resonance stabilizing effect. If we see example of alpha D-glucose 6 phosphate and L-glycerol 3 phosphate, these molecules do not have different resonance stabilizing effect, and their hydrolysis products are not at much different energy as compared to their resonance stabilizing structure. So that's why they do not produce energy during the hydrolysis. So another class of compound, phosphoguanidines. Phosphoguanidines contains phosphocreatine and phosphoarginine. These two compounds contain resonance stabilizing effect of lone pair between two highly electronegative atoms, oxygen and nitrogen. Because of difference in the energy of hydrolysis product and the resonance stabilizing effect, these molecules produce energy when hydrolyzed. The muscle cells and the nerve cells in the mammals and eukaryotes have the turnover of ATP through the phosphoguanidines. So these phosphoguanidines irreversibly attach to the ATP, and whenever ATP is required, they release the ATP. For example, ATP plus creatine interact with each other and make the phosphocreatine plus ADP. And this reaction has an energy of 12.6 kilojoule per mole. If we see the reactants and the products of this reaction occurs almost near to equilibrium. So whenever we are in the resting stage, phosphocreatine is made more and more. And if we are under high metabolic activity, this reaction goes in backward direction and more ATP and creatine is released. Nucleoside triphosphates are freely interconverted. For the synthesis of protein and the nucleic acid, we do need the nucleoside triphosphate instead of ATP. For example, during the synthesis of RNA, the ribonucleotide. For example, during the RNA synthesis, cytidine triphosphate, guanidine triphosphate, uridine triphosphate, and adenosine triphosphate is required. And during the DNA synthesis, deoxycytidine phosphate, deoxyguanidine triphosphate, and deoxythymidine triphosphate, and deoxyadenosine triphosphate is required. For example, this is a reaction in which ATP binds with the NDP nucleotide diphosphate and make ADP and nucleotide triphosphate. And in the case of DNA, it will be deoxynucleotide triphosphate. Delta G values for these reactions is near to zero. The reactions are driven by the depletion of nucleotide triphosphates. Adenylate kinase converts the nucleotide monophosphate at the expense of ATP. We can see this reaction here. AMP reacts with ATP to make the two ATP molecules. So this is the enzyme from the E. coli that is utilized to make the nucleotides. So in this slide, we will be studying that thioesters are energy-rich compounds. So thioesters are one of the primitive high energy compounds. They are present in central metabolic system of all known organisms. So that they are producing ATP independent of oxidative phosphorylation. So this is the structure formula of acetyl coenzyme A. So this enzyme has different structural components. For example, this has adenosine 3-phosphate and one pentathenic acid residue and one beta mercaptoethanol amine residue and one acetyl group. We can see thioester group is here. So during the hydrolysis of this thioester group, energy is released and ATP are synthesized. Experimental approaches to the study of metabolism. In this section, we will see how the metabolic pathways are studied by the use of labeled art radioisotopes. We will also see the steps of pathways that can be identified by the use of metabolic inhibitors. DNA array and proteome approaches will also be discussed how they are utilized in the study of metabolic pathways. A cell's metabolic activity is reflected in its metabolomics. Experimental approaches to the study of metabolism. So there are different levels at which we can study and understand the metabolic pathways. The first approach is to use the sequence of reactions in which specific nutrients are converted to the end products, and we can also study the energetics at this level. The second level of study is the study of enzymes that catalyze the reactions. We can understand their mechanism by separating those enzymes and studying them both in vitro and in vivo. The third level of study is the control mechanism, in which different inter-organs communication is used to control the metabolism. We can study those inter-organ communication. A metabolic pathway is followed by labeling the metabolites. But there is a drawback of labeling the metabolites, that its molecular weight is changed. That's why we utilize the radioactive isotope that doesn't change the molecular weight of a metabolite. And we can trace that radioactively labeled metabolite in the metabolic pathway. So these are the list of some of the fluorescent markers utilized in the biochemistry, like amino coumarin, fluorescein, cyanin-3, Texasret. These are the list of some of the radioisotopes that are utilized in biochemistry, like carbon-14, fluorine-18, sodium-22, phosphorus-32, and the sulfur-35. Those have all different half-lives, and they are a source of different kinds of radiations. So study of metabolic pathway often involves perturbing the system. So we can use different inhibitors to perturb the system, and this way some of the metabolites can be accumulated and we can study the specific reaction that is regulated by an enzyme. For example, we can use the different inhibitors in the electron transport chain, and we can understand how each of the complex in the mitochondria is utilized during the electron transport chain reaction and to produce energy. Studying metabolic pathway often involves perturbing the system. So this is the data taken from the sample obtained from the rat liver, and we can see in the graph that there is some peak that is showing this class of compound, and this is the double bond containing compounds, and this peak shows the glycogen level in that sample, and these are some glucose and glycogen related identification of carbon atoms. After this rat was injected with radio labeled glucose, we can see there was increase in the level of glucose in the rat liver. We can see this C1b, and this is beta glucose, and this is the alpha glucose. And after the 30 minutes, we observed that there was increase in the peak that correspond to the glycogen level. So this way the metabolites can be labeled and then can be traced in the NMR and some other pathways. In this way, the metabolites can be labeled and can be traced by the NMR and by some other techniques. So this is another pathway that is showing the degradation of the phenylalanine. In this pathway, this enzyme was defective, and this way there is accumulation of homogeneities. System biology has entered the study of metabolism. So metabolism also requires the study of genome, the transcriptome and the proteome, and definitely the metabolome is also required to fully understand the metabolism. In the genome, we study that if some of the gene is defective that is involved in some metabolic pathway or not. Or there is a possibility that some of the mRNA correspond to a specific enzyme is not properly working and is mutant. And there is possibility that some of the enzyme is being degraded at a higher rate and is not functional in a metabolic pathway. And because of these all approaches, some of the metabolite can be accumulated, can be excessively made, and that metabolite is studied by the use of NMR and by the mass spectrometry. I'm showing you here one example in which system biology is utilized to study the metabolism of the yeast. So yeast was grown in the presence of glucose and in the absence of glucose. And after the growth, the mRNA was extracted from both types of yeast. And each type of yeast was labeled with red fluorescent dye and with the green fluorescent dye, and the cDNA was synthesized. This cDNA was mixed together and was poured on a multi-channel plate. This plate is containing the immobilized fragments of DNA from the different genes. If the glucose presence is activating some of the gene, then that well will be showing the red fluorescence. If some of the gene is activated in the absence of glucose, that will be showing the green fluorescence in that multi-channel plate. If the both are activated in both conditions, like in the presence of glucose and in the absence of glucose, that will be showing the yellow fluorescence. It means that those genes are unaffected whether the glucose is present or whether the glucose is absent. This is another study in which the samples from the hepatocellular carcinoma patients and from the non-tumor liver were collected, and were cDNA was extracted, and then the study of gene expression was performed. X-axis is showing the different types of samples and different conditions, while the y-axis is showing different genes, but the gene names are not written because they were thousands in number. We can see here the red area is showing that these genes are overly expressed in the HCC patients, while those same genes were less expressed in the non-tumor patients. These genes may be involved in the proliferation, in the angiogenesis, and also in some other metabolic pathways. And in the same way, we can see this class of compound is less expressed in the HCC patients and they are overly expressed in the non-tumor liver. So these genes may be involved in the tumor suppressor functions. That's why they are absent in HCC patients and tumors are there. Proteomics studies all the cell's proteins. Unfortunately, there is a poor correlation between the mRNA and its corresponding protein. So that's why study of transcriptome is not enough. And qPCR is not going to give us the final results. And we have to study the level of protein of different genes. So this is done in the proteomics. Proteomics does use the 2D gel electrophoresis to separate out the proteins, and then the overly expressed and down expressed proteins are isolated and then are identified. This way we can know which of the protein is overly expressed in certain metabolic conditions. Metabolomics analyzes all the cell's metabolites. So under some metabolic conditions, some of the enzymes are present in high concentration and some of the metabolites are accumulated and some of the metabolites are consumed. In the same way, lipidomics is important in the study of metabolomics. Thank you for watching. This is end of chapter 14.